نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم عبد الله ورسوله، أرسله ربه بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ألا وإن كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. I bear witness that there is none worthy of our worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace be upon him, is the seal of the prophets and the final messenger to all of humanity. Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, there is none to misguide. And whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leads to stray, there is no one to guide. اليوم إن شاء الله نتكلم عن يعني موضوع مهم جدا. هذا الأسبوع توفي أحد الطلاب هنا في المدرسة في grade 6، يعني كان عنده 12 سنة تقريبا، اسمه برهان. فطبعا الأمر حدث، هو موت مفاجئ، والناس ما كانوا يعرفوا أنه عنده مشكلة في القلب وكذا، وتوفاه الله. فطبعا هذا يعطينا إشارة، إذا كان طفل صغير أو ولد صغير عنده 12 سنة مات بدون مقدمات، فالموت لا يحتاج إلى مقدمات. الناس تظن أنه لازم تكون عجوز وختيار وسنانك بتوقع وعندك عصاية وكذا، ولكن هذا ليس صحيح. فالسؤال الآن، إذا كان الإنسان منا سيموت الآن في هذه اللحظة، ليس غدا أو بعد غد أو بعد غد، الآن في هذه اللحظة، هل كل واحد فينا مستعد أنه مات في هذه اللحظة، مستعد أنه خلاص يموت ويقابل الله سبحانه وتعالى ويجاوب على الأسئلة، والكتاب باليمين وجنة أو نار؟ انسى بقى موضوع أولادك وموضوع زوجتك وكذا، هيتخانوا على الميراث والعربية والسيارة والبيوت والأموال وكذا، والشغل عندك وهذه الأمور كلها ما تشغلش بالك. المهم دلوقتي، هل إحنا جاهزين؟ الإنسان إذا مات الآن عنده رصيد من الحسنات يكفي إنه هو يدخل الجنة؟ وإذا ما كانش مستعد، والله سبحانه وتعالى من عليك وأعطاك فرصة تانية إنك تتوب وتعمل الصالحات، هل أنت جاهز إنك تعمل هذا الموضوع؟ فهذا يعني باختصار هو موضوع الخطبة في هذا اليوم. ف this week everyone was shocked because there was a student in our class, main gate, who passed away. He is in grade 6, Burhan, rahimahullah, 12 years old, very young. So everyone was in shock. He was on a camping trip with his family. He was healthy. I've known him for about 5 weeks. Alhamdulillah, we played soccer together in the backyard last week. He was healthy, 12-year-old kid. So it was something that is unexpected that happened. So, and because of this undiagnosed heart problem that he had, he passed away, right? So now this will motivate me to give this khutbah today. And before we do that, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give his family sabr and to make it easy for them and to bless his two brothers. I spoke with his father and mother yesterday, and alhamdulillah, they are very patient. They're accepting of Qadr Allah. And I know it's a very devastating experience for any one of us. My wife and myself, we had two miscarriages before, and that was one of the most difficult things. But now your kid is 12 years old, 13 years old, mashallah, he's going to school, a brilliant student, and all of a sudden you lose your baby and you don't know what to do. This is a very tough thing to do. Even Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam cried when his children died. We know that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had 7 kids. He had 7 children, 4 girls and 3 boys. And he lost 6 of them in his life, 3 boys and 3 girls. So imagine every year or two, every now and then, he would take one of his kids to the graveyard for burial, 6 times in his lifetime. But still, as-sahaba kanu yaqulun bil-raghm min inni 6 min awlad matu, والمصائب والمشاكل وفاة خديجة والحصار قريش واصحابه كانوا يموتون وكذا. Although all these problems happened to Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, his kids died, 6 of them in his lifetime. His wife Khadija passed away. His uncle Abu Talib, the people of Mecca were giving him a hard time. They killed some of his Sahaba. كان الصحابة يقولون والله ما رأينا أحدا أكثر تبسما من محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. They said, we have never seen anyone who smiled more than Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. The smile was always on his face. He never questioned Allah. He never said, okay, why are you doing this to me? Why me? Six kids, and my neighbor is 70 years old and he's still running around. Okay, he should die, not my kids. He never did that. He said, إن العين لتدمع وإن القلب ليحزن ولا نقول إلا ما يرضي ربنا. He said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, my heart is broken, my eyes are full of tears, but I only say what is pleasing to Allah. I cannot complain, because he knows that this life is very short. We're here for a short period of time, eventually we'll go to Jannah in the mercy and the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? And we will all be there. The brother who passed away, Burhan, my father, your great-grandfather, all of those who passed away, one day, inshallah, we'll go there, we'll be with them. Who wants to stay in this miserable world anyway? The wars, the bloodshed, cold weather, 40 minus, gas prices, Fort Mac, and 13% in tax. You lost your mind, who wants to stay here? But if you go to Jannah, one day inshallah we'll give khutbah about Jannah, you would love to go there. You would love to be in Jannah with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You look at the face of Allah, you see the Sahaba kiram, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Yusuf alayhi salam, Ibrahim. Who doesn't want to go there? Right? So all of us, we would love to go there. We will be in the mercy and the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And once both of your feet are inside, you will never leave, you will never die. And this is the greatest joy of the ni'mah. Because here in dunya, if you have money, you're afraid that one chore or one hirsiz is gonna come and break into your house and steal your money. Or you will die and you leave your money behind. But Jannah is totally different. You will not be taken out of it and you will not die. وَمَا هُمْ مِنْهَا بِمُخْرَجِينَ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا. But now the question is, this is the $1 million question that no one is willing to answer. So if I kindly request everyone here in the masjid, brothers and sisters, old and young, just close your eyes for me. Close your eyes and pretend that you died now. Khalas, you died. You gave us your last breath. You're standing before Allah for judgment. What are you going to tell Him? What answers will you give for the bad things we do day and night? All of us are sinful. We make mistakes. We're not angels. We're not prophets. We're not Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What are you going to tell Him? Are you ready to go now? Do you have enough balance in your hasanat to go to Jannah, or you think you are going to end up in barbecue? Right? So you have to have some convincing answers for some of the difficult questions about the terrible things that we do. You can open your eyes now. But now you got the concept that it is real. If it happened to Brother Burhan, who was 12 years old, a student in the Main Gate Academy, it can happen to you. You don't have to be 70 years old or 80 years old with gray hair, fallen teeth, and a cane to die. It happens to 2-year-olds, 12-year-olds, 50 years old, 100 years old, right? It can happen to anyone. There's no time for death to come. But when I ask someone, what happens if you die now, not after Maghrib, not after Ramadan, next year, no, now, what will happen? The first thing they will say, oh, my family will be devastated, my wife will be miserable, my kids will be in the streets, and my job, man, the company will fall apart. Canada will be devastated. The universe will be in trouble. The sun and the moon and the stars are gonna start falling down. If this is what you think, then I got some bad news for you. Nothing of that kind will happen. Your kids, after you die, they bury you, they will be fighting over your money, who's gonna take the car, who's gonna take the house and the bank account. Don't worry about them. Don't worry about your wife. The chances are, if she's good looking and young, she's gonna get married to another guy in 2 years. And don't worry about your husband. He's gonna get married in 2 weeks. Even if he's ugly, he will find someone to marry. So don't worry about them. Just worry about yourself. What are you gonna tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Your job, forget it. They'll get another guy. who will do double the job, take half the pay. So your boss is basically going to be dancing in the street. Everyone will be happy. They will pray, "Ya Allah, why didn't you take him 10 years ago?" I'm serious here, wallahi. I'm trying to be honest with you. So don't think when you die that the universe will be destroyed. When Muhammad died, life goes on. I know it was a devastating experience for Sahaba, but life goes on. We're not here to stay, right? And forget about the stars and the moon and the galaxies falling down. When Ibrahim, the son of Muhammad died, it happened to be, there was a solar eclipse, khusuf al-shams. So some of the Sahaba said, "Oh, subhanAllah, the universe is in grief because the son of Muhammad died." And the Prophet gave khutbah and he said, "This is not right." He said, "Inna shamsa wal qamar la yankasifani li mawti ahadin wala li hayatihi. Fa idha ra'aytumuha fafza'u ila as-salah." He said, "It is foolish to think that the sun or the moon will eclipse for anyone's life or death. These are two natural signs of Allah. So when you see a solar eclipse, just make salah. That's it." You know, this is how the Prophet ﷺ reacted to these things. SubhanAllah, our problem, I'll give you the problem, then I'll give you the solution at the end. Sometimes, as I said, we think that you have to get a sign before you die. Like your teeth are going to start falling one by one, your hair will be gray, the cane, you'll have doctor appointments every day. "Oh, my knee, my head, my legs," you know. So we expect a sign that we're going to die. Like some people think, like, subhanAllah, they're going to get an email or a fax, "Oh, Mr. Ibrahim, you're going to die next month on the 12th at 4:30. This will never happen. We don't have the choice. We don't know. The prophets of Allah, Muhammad ﷺ, Musa, the different prophets, they knew. They were given the option when the angel came to them, angel of death, "Would you like to die now or stay?" They have that option. We don't have that option. When the time comes, you just go, right? You can't say, "I can't. You know, my wife is there, my kids, I have to stay with them." No. When it is time, you just go. There's no sign. They say, subhanAllah, fi al-tafkira al-Qurtubi, fi ibn tafsir ibn Kathir, in these two books, that when it was time for Dawood alayhi salam to die, he didn't get very old or anything. He was like a normal person. Healthy and everything, maybe 60 years old, 50 years old. He was not very old. So when the angel of death came to him, and he said, "Okay, would you like to die now or get more time?" He said, "SubhanAllah, I thought that I see some signs before I die, like gray hair, the teeth, and all these things." He said, No. "We already sent you signs. We sent you messages all along, but, you know." So Dawood alayhi salam said, "Okay, what kind of messages? I don't think I received messages that I'm going to die." He said, "Okay, first of all, where is your father?" He said, "Died, first time." "Where is your uncle?" "Died." "Your mother?" "Died." "Your neighbor?" "Died." He said, "These are the signs. If someone else died, people keep dying every day, this is the sign that one day is going to be your turn." العلماء say, يعني إذا كان ملك الموت تخطاك اليوم حتى يأخذ إنسانا آخر فسيأتي اليوم الذي يتخطى الآخرين ليصل إليه. So the scholars say, just like when the angel of death skips you today to take someone else, one day he's going to skip someone else to come and take you. There's no running away. And the people, subhanAllah, مسألة الأمل, الأمل عنده المسألة الأمل وكذا عنده أمال عريضة. And the Prophet ﷺ says in the authentic hadith, رسم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he knew that people are visual. So he used to draw things on the sand, so he drew a box, a square, and he said, "This is your life, and out of the square, big lines that go all the way to the window this way, and the window this way." He said the square, and this is in Sahih Bukhari, he said the square, "This is your life. And the two arrows going out all the way to the windows on both sides, this is your hope in life. You have plans for 40, 50 years from today. You don't know that maybe you will die tomorrow, but the hope, we have big hopes, high expectations in life, but most of the time we never live to fulfill all these hopes and expectations in life. So when you see people dying around you, so someone, your neighbor today, your grandfather, your aunt, your uncle, you think, oh, subhanAllah, everyone is dying except me. It seems like I'm not gonna die. So this reminds me of a story of like after Ramadan, before Eid al-Adha, Qurbani. So a family, they bought a kharuf, a goat or a sheep, 2 months before Eid al-Adha, Qurbani Eid. So they treated the kharuf very nicely. They gave him a room in the house, the goat or the sheep. They gave the goat or the sheep a room in the house. And they were feeding him nicely, ice cream, good food. And they gave him a seat on the table, a chair around the table. They brushed his teeth. They gave him a shower, bubble bath, clothes. You know, they were treating him very nicely. So much so that they made him feel at home, like, oh man, this is my house. On the day of Eid al-Adha, when they prayed Salatul Eid, and everyone went to their house to get their kharuf, to offer it qurbani, to sacrifice this goat or the sheep, and the kharuf was sitting in the balcony, and he saw people taking their goat or sheep one by one to sacrifice them. So the kharuf, the goat or the sheep, told the people who were hosting him, he said, subhanAllah, everyone got a kharuf, a goat or a sheep for qurbani, except us. You know what I mean? So it came to a point where he thought that he was another human being. He would never be sacrificed like other goats and sheep. And this is the way we think sometimes. Everyone is dying except for us. I have been here for a long time. I will never die. So you shouldn't think like this. So how do you become positive about this thing? And if we happen to die today and go and meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will you have enough hasanat? If you want to be in a good position, and you don't want to be in trouble on that day, so there are a few things you need to make, few steps that you need to take. The first one, you have to do your wasiyah. And this is my advice to everyone. One day, inshallah, after Ramadan, if Allah gives me life, I have high expectations. So if I'm here, inshallah, I will give a khutbah about wasiyah, how to make your wasiyah, what happens in your janazah, how to distribute. You don't have to be specific about who takes what, but if you want to make wasiyah, give up to 1/3 of your money for sadaqah or something. If you have debts, if you owe someone some money, someone owes you money, this is your wasiyah. And it is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And number two, tawbah. All of us make mistakes by day and night. This is the nature of being a human being. Who is better, you or Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He is better than all of us. And the Prophet ﷺ would say in an authentic hadith, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ تُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا فَإِنِّي أَتُوبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا فِي الْيَوْمِ مِئَةَ مَرَّةٍ. So in this authentic hadith, the Prophet ﷺ would say, oh people, make tawbah, ask Allah for forgiveness. I myself, he didn't have sins. He didn't have sins. Everything was forgiven, but still he would say, I make tawbah, I ask Allah for forgiveness 100 times every day. 100 times. Ah, I'm better than everyone. This is what we think. I'm not doing anything. I'm innocent. Everyone else is a thief. Everyone is a chore. Everyone is hearses. No one prays their salah and namaz. I pray Jummah. I'm better than everyone else, right? So this is how we think. So every day before you go to sleep, when you put your head on that pillow, make tawbah. It doesn't take 5 seconds. Ya Allah, forgive me. I'm sorry. I made a mistake. Forgive me. That's all it takes. Make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also do a lot of good deeds. Do a lot of good deeds. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, whoever dies after fasting Ramadan, they will go straight to Jannah. If you say La ilaha illallah and this is the last thing you do in your life, you'll go straight to Jannah. If you die after Salah, you'll go straight to Jannah. Some of us, they play games with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't pray at all. No Salah whatsoever. And they say, oh subhanallah, I'm a good guy. Inshallah, I will die in a state of sujood. How can you die in sujood if you don't even pray? This is a joke, right? So can I please ask you to move forward, because there are a lot of people standing back. Move up, please. Jazakumullah khair. If you see a spot in front of you, move up, please. Jazakumullah khair. So doing your wasiyah, making tawbah, doing good deeds. Very briefly, we know that as Muslims, we have two obligations. Your obligation is toward Allah, Salah, if you don't pray on time, make sure you pray. Fasting, fast properly in Ramadan. In the next few khutbas, inshallah, we'll talk about this. If you have money, you don't pay your zakah, make sure you pay your zakah on time. If you have money, you didn't go for hajj, make sure you go for hajj. These are the rights of Allah. Then you have the rights of the people. Your rights toward your husband or your wife, your children, your father, your mother, fellow Muslims, your brothers and sisters in humanity. You have to be good, honest, nice. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about these two rights all the time. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ They have faith in Allah, they fulfill their duty to Allah, and they do good deeds to their fellow human beings and the rest of the creation of Allah. So the rights of Allah and the rights of the people. And also you need to take advantage of the five things that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about in the hadith al-Bayhaqi, Sunan al-Bayhaqi. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, اغتنم خمسا قبل خمس. He said, take advantage of five things before the coming of five things. شبابك قبل هيومك. When you are young and healthy, energetic, take advantage of that. Right? If you want to memorize Quran, this is the time. If you want to play sports, this is the time. If you want to travel the world, this is the time. Because once you hit a certain age, it will become very difficult for you to memorize. You'll have doctor appointments, you can't run around, basketball, you can't do all of these things, right? You can't do all of these things. So take advantage of this, as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. Then he said, وَصِحَّتَكَ قَبْلَ سِقَمِكَ And when you are healthy, before you become sick. وَغِنَاكَ قَبْلَ فَقْرِكَ When you have money, you are rich, you have the resources, take care of that. Before you become sick, وَحَيَاتِكَ قَبْلَ مَوْتِكَ And your life before your death, وَفَرَاغَكَ قَبْلَ شُغْلِكَ When you are free, you have plenty of free time before you become busy. You never know what will happen next. So we need to take advice of this wasiyah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us and give us the best in this life and the best in the life to come. Inshallah, Allah will come. الحمد لله رب العالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أرسله ربه رحمة للعالمين. So as I said in the first khutbah, if it is time for us to go now, we have to be ready, because there are no second chances. We read in Surah Fatir, when someone dies, they will say, Ya Rabb, Rabb al-Ju'un, I want to go back. There are no second chances. Once we die, and there are a million causes for death, heart attack, this, that, cancer, tumor, you know, the causes are so many. But you don't need a cause to die. If it is the qadr of Allah for you to go, you will go. Death itself is the cause. And as I said, don't worry about your wife, your husband, your kids, your job,